You mentioned about going mad earlier, but one person says, is it safe for someone with an ICD to go on roller coasters and large funfair rides? I'm idiopathic and I love roller coasters.
Do you know what, this is a really good question. So this is from the questions that I had a look at before that were sent in earlier.
Which is your favourite?
This was the only question I had to look up. I've got to be honest, I've never been asked, can you go on a roller coaster?
Really?
With your defibrillator and if you've had idiopathic tachycardia quest. So it's an interesting one. Obviously the older, you can look at it in two ways. So the way I looked at it was that, do you have some sort of tachycardiomyopathy, some sort of underlying condition, which means that if you are, if you have increased heightened tensions with adrenaline rushing through you, you know, being scared sets off a cardiac arrest, for example, then you probably shouldn't go on a roller coaster, in all fairness. But if it's not related to that, then that's not a problem. The next thing to look about is the interaction between the roller coaster and the device. Now, the companies don't advise you against going on a roller coaster. I phoned one of them up and I asked them today. Thanks, Floyd, from Boston. And because the magnets are so far away. Now, magnets are the things that affect devices and can temporarily deactivate your ICD. And they're used in emergency situations. And they're like a fail-safe system. If someone is admitted for some emergency operation where they're using diathermy, for example, which can affect the device, you put a magnet over the device and it stops you from having being mistreated and having a shock for a normal heart movement.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously some of the roller coasters use big magnets to make sure the cart stay on the track and that you go up and then you come down, or you stop at the top and whatever, you know, things like that. So that's not an issue. The only other issue is on some of the rides, and they vary. So if you've just got a seatbelt that goes across you, fine, not a problem. If you've got something that goes across like a seatbelt from right to left and your device is on your left side, not a problem. If you've got something that comes down over you and tracks you in like that, so you're strapped in,
mm-hmm.
they're quite heavy and there's a lot of banging going along. That's going to increase your heart rate because of the sensors inside the device. You know, it's going to potentially cause some bruising. I think, and sometimes I know you're upside down and you're hanging in, you're thinking, please let this hold on to me, I don't want to go down there type thing. So lots of things to take into account, but just be sensible with it. If you love roller coasters, then my idea is that you've got to enjoy life.
Mm-hmm.
You have to do things in moderation. And if going on a roller coaster gives you that enjoyment, then to be honest, do it.
Cool.
If it's not worth the risk, then don't do it. You can only judge yourself on that one, I think. But you know, I do believe strongly in doing things in moderation, but enjoying life. You know, you guys have a life-changing experience that I've never really experienced. But I see the aftermath of it, and I see how worried people are, and it's not good for you.
I think, to be fair, he does say large funfair rides. I think this is a proper...
Is this a wooden one, though?
I think you should stop that, because you're destroying my excuse for not going on.
I was actually going to temper it slightly the way. Maybe I'm a bit boring compared to our non-physician colleagues here, but I would just say that I liken it a little bit to swimming. I wouldn't go freshwater swimming in the sea with no one about, but I would go in a swimming pool with a lifeguard, or even a beach with a lifeguard, and I'd tell them before I go in. Like this one, I would go on, you know, something, but would I go on the upside down one that really pulls on my... I think that's not necessarily a great idea, to be honest. So I think, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't.
Yeah.
If people want to do that, that's fine. But the other thing is, of course, is if it shocks you upside down at 130 metres, you know, it's going to end up less well than if you're on terra firma with some people to give you a hand if you feel a bit dizzy. Do you know what I mean? So I completely agree with you. I think we have to be sensible. It'll be completely dependent on individuals to individuals and situations of life. But for me, the big rocking roller coasters with an ICD, probably not the greatest idea.
I'm sure there's probably warnings on
some of them.
I'm sure there's the signs that say, you know, do not try to get
pregnant,
back
got
pain,
problem,
heart problems, things like that.
But that's actually, at the end of the day, the individual can take that risk, but I think it's probably a, not the best decision, would be my honest opinion, but I think people can do what they want.
Okay. Talking about sort of discomfort on the actual implant site, which you get after you've had it done, but is it normal to start feeling discomfort months or years after implant, after implantation? And also, how many ICDs can a body tolerate? And I'm assuming they don't mean at once. And is the risk of infection increased the more you have? I'm only 28 and on number 4 already. I worry about how many my body will tolerate.
Good question.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'll keep it simple. I am very simple with my answers about most things. I think what is definite is that ICDs, as you know, sit underneath often muscles that run across the chest that do work the arm in a variety of ways. And so it's not uncommon for patients to complain of pain, either acutely and it gets better, or actually, sadly, the worst ones, I think, are the ones where they don't have too much pain and it gets worse, because then you need to think about repositioning it. And I think that's a shame. I think the honest answer is that every time we open up a device, i.e. open the skin to either change the lead or change the device or have a box change, there absolutely is an inherent risk of infection of 1% or less. And so unfortunately, yes, the more adjustments you have by making a cut and changing the box or putting it in a slightly different place and sewing it up again, absolutely there is unfortunately an inherent risk of infection. Maybe James was going to go on to this. What may be useful for you and maybe other patients like you in time is the subcutaneous ICD, as James showed, which we know can sit in a variety of pockets, in a variety of places potentially, and is obviously not in the business zone of moving your arms, and that's the whole point. And in young people that need multiple devices over their lifetime, and as they get even smaller than this, this is probably where this guy may benefit, or other people like him may benefit.
No, definitely. I mean, the subcutaneous ICD, as Tom said again, and we said earlier, sits on the side, and there's no lead inside the heart, so it's not taking up valuable space. Because when the lead goes inside the heart, it grows around it to secure it, and so that makes it difficult to pull it out, so it's not a simple procedure to pull it out. The exciting thing is that as technology's improving, is that these devices are going to be working with these devices and communicating with the leadless pacemaker. So if you have heart failure, for example, that you need a CRT defibrillator, but you've had infections, for example, in the future we may be able to implant one on the side and then the leadless pacemaker, and it will communicate with each other. And there are some small studies with primitive technology going on at the moment to help that. I'd like to add that the discomfort months or years after implanting, we do see it, it's not uncommon. It could be for a variety of reasons. If you started taking up the gym, for example, what we would advise is to keep an eye on the actual wound. So if it's showing signs of infection, so if it's red, if it's swollen, if it's weeping, if it's hot to touch on that side and you compare it to the other side where you haven't got your device and it's hot that way, they're all obvious signs of infection. And we always advise you guys just to give us a call up and tell us that there's been a sudden change. If you've got a temperature, call us up, because we'll need to get you in and have a look at it, a closer look at it. So to this gentleman or lady that is potentially having this issue at the moment, get in touch with your clinic, let them know. Hopefully we'll say come in and we'll have a look at it, and we can have a look at it, and if it looks fine, great, you'll rest assured. Don't stay out there in the dark. We're quite accessible. Give us a call, that's always the best way. Give us a call, write to us. I wouldn't necessarily just pop into your clinic. Them ad hoc appointments always put extra stress on us, and we can't necessarily see you in a timely manner, and if you're travelling 30, 40 miles just to get to us, and you could be disappointed, unfortunately. We always try to see you guys, but it's not always possible.
Someone's just asked, could you have a deep infection if you've got an SICD without it being obvious on the surface?
But for a subcutaneous ICD? So it's like at any point you can, if you get infected on your device, it will track round. The advantage is that it's not going to track into the heart. And that's unfortunately what happens with the standard ICDs. If the device gets infected, the infection tracks down the lead into the heart, and that's where we get serious complications. So that's one of the advantages of the subcutaneous defibrillator.
Okay. And just following on from that, when they change the actual, they're talking about an SICD, but it also applies to a normal ICD, do they change the leads when they change? They say the battery, but the battery is the unit.
So it's just the can that we change. The leads have really good lifetime expectancies on them now. As Tom alluded to earlier in the conversation, when you've got something that works and isn't broke, don't fix it.
Absolutely.
And it's very similar with the subcutaneous lead at the minute. It's incredibly strong. I haven't seen any issues with lead integrity or fracturing, for example, with these leads. But what we always do is we check it. Even when you get your ICD changed, we check the leads to make sure there hasn't been any damage during the procedure, for example. Sometimes in the old days, I say old days, 15 years ago, they may pull the leads out and they just fell apart. But that was the technology and the equipment that they were using. Nowadays, I have never come across a lead just falling apart. So it's very unlikely. But obviously, with anything, sometimes it comes to its end of its lifetime and we do have to replace it.
Okay, and this is also about leads. This person's got a son, or baby almost, who's only 2 years old, and obviously he's going to be needing a lot of ICDs through his life. And it says, is there going to be enough room on the heart for all these multiple leads?
It's a challenge. I must be honest, I'm not a paediatric cardiac physiologist, Tom's not a paediatric consultant, but what we do know is that obviously younger patients require multiple devices, so the less equipment they put in at the start means that there's more room. At some point, I would imagine that they have to take out some of the leads, so that would be a procedure where they had to use certain bits of kit just to ease the leads out and pull them out to allow for more room and for new devices and new leads to go in.
But I mean, I think that's a very fair question next time they're having it checked to ask the physician who's looking after you and say, do you know what, we just give us a heads up, just let us know, you know, what can we expect at the moment? Because, and then the other caveat is, I think that things will change. I think even if they say now that you're going to need a new device every however many years or a new lead every X, Y, and Z years, that the future is whatever it is, and I'm sorry we don't know that, but as I say, we have to be fair that when we don't know something, we will just say.
We know technology's improved. I mean, it's taken 50 odd years to go from a pacemaker to this size, so the technology will follow.
Absolutely,
it will definitely follow where it will. They will miniaturise the ICDs from that down to something like that to get all the necessary gadgets inside there, and that will help obviously. But unfortunately, I think for that patient, they will require probably some other procedures to remove some of the equipment.
Okay. If you're unlucky enough to actually...